for this Ephesian church. And I think it gives us some insight into the things that we could pray for our church and for all of the Lord's churches that we know of across the land. Turn with me in the first chapter, and we'll begin reading with verse 16. Verse 15, he said, "Wherefore I," verse 16, "cease not to give thanks for you." That's after he learned of their salvation and of their being established a church. He ceased not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. What did Paul pray for? Well, that God would give the church the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. He prayed that their eyes of understanding might be enlightened. He prayed that they may know the hope that is in his calling, called to be saints, the hope that every saint, every born-again child of God ought to have, that expectation of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that expectation of this body being laid in the grave and asleep, he calls it, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And the expectation of that body living again, of being a changed body, like unto our Lord and Savior's body. That he prayed that they might know the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. As saints, we have a rich inheritance that is laid up for us, not only in his presence, well, it is in his presence, you see, but it is a glorious inheritance, and we even get a glimpse, a glorious glimpse of that in the book of Revelation in chapter 21 to his bride, who is seated there with him on the throne in that new city, Jerusalem, and look at the picture that is painted there in the 21st chapter of the book of Revelation. He said he prayed that the church would have spiritual eyes to see the greatness of God. Do we see the greatness of God? Do we keep the greatness of God before our eyes? Well, the best way to keep it before our eyes is, as we said this morning, the first book that we ought to pick up every day is this book right here. See, we ought to take it in hand, and that's the best way to keep a view of the greatness of our God. He prayed that they might see and know the working, that they might experience the working of his mighty power. And if I'm not mistaken, this is the point that we've been dealing with the last time, and now this time we'll continue that thought. The working of his mighty power. Last time we looked at the fact that God brought Israel out of Egypt by his mighty power. His mighty power, he brought them out. And we can go back to the book of Exodus and we can read the accounting and the plagues that he had to bring upon the Egyptians, but it was his mighty power at work. Until finally, the Egyptians said, go, get out of here. And then they changed their mind and pursued them, but that was their destruction in the Red Sea. God's mighty power split the Red Sea and the waters stood up. He struggled. That's an east wind or a west wind. Caused a mighty wind anyhow, and the water stood up. And they didn't have to wait for the ground to dry out, for the wind to dry that ground out. The ground was dry and they went across on dry ground. If you know anything about riverbeds and the beds of seas and stuff, they're mucky. You know, that would have taken days, weeks to dry up and that muck to clear out. Not the power of God behind him. See? He wanted his, God wanted his, wants us to know. He wanted the Ephesians to know. He wants us to know his mighty power. He wants his mighty power known unto us, so he works mightily in us. Worked mightily to the salvation of the Egyptians, or not the Egyptians, the Israelites, and he's worked mightily to save us. Our salvation. We'll see more of that as we go on concerning this power that he's talking about. We said that 63 times in the book of Ezekiel, God says to Ezekiel, ye shall know that I am the Lord. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. And that goes to Jehovah, the ever-existing one, the ever-living one, the one full of power and might and wisdom and knowledge. Tonight, we want to carry on that thought. And the third point of that thought of that we might know his mighty power, and he wants us to know his mighty power. The fact is that you and I, we need to know. We need to be aware of his mighty power. The power of Almighty God. Turn with me into the book of Matthew chapter 22, and we have a lot of scriptures this evening. You almost think, well, it's a Bible study rather than preaching. Well, let that be as it may, but it's the Word of God, and these verses that we looked at, they reveal to us the mighty power of God in Matthew chapter 22. And verse 29, Jesus here had been talking to the Sadducees. And you know who the Sadducees were, do you not? Yeah, they didn't believe in the resurrection, did they? They were Sadducees. Not believing in the resurrection will make you sad, you see. But he said in verse 29, he said, they asked him the question. He said, in the resurrection, this man had seven wives, or this wife had seven husbands, each of them brothers, you know. And she married a brother, and he died. And so the Israelite custom was that the next brother, if he'd not married, he would pick it up and carry on, raise up children unto his brother. Well, she did that, and she did that seven times. They all died. I mean, I think I would say, oh no, you're hard on husbands. I don't want anything to do with you. But he had seven husbands. And they asked him, she said, so in the resurrection, whose wife will she be? Look at Jesus' reply. Jesus answered and said unto them, ye do err, not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. Listen, a man that does not believe in the resurrection, he doesn't know the scriptures, and he doesn't know the power of God. I question whether he knows the power of God in salvation. Because it's that same mighty power. Listen, if there's no resurrection, there's no salvation. If there's no power in the resurrection, there's no power in salvation. It takes the same mighty power. Compare that with some scriptures that they should have known. Turn with me to the book of Job in chapter 19. And the book of Job is most things. I don't believe I've read a commentary or a scriptural historian, even the Jewish writers, attribute Job as being the oldest book of the Bible, written even before the Pentateuch. They often refer to people in Jesus' day having the law and the prophets, and basically that all, I guess you could, in some respects, consider Job a prophet. He wasn't really a prophet. Job is attributed for being the oldest book in the Word of God. With that in thought, look at what Job said, and these Sadducees should have known that. They were students of the Word, but they were ignorant of the resurrection. Verse 25, Job said, for I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. He said, my Redeemer. He knew the power of God in salvation, the power of God to redeem him, and he knew that his Redeemer was going to go. He was going to give his life on the cross. He was going to die, and he was going to resurrect. And he says, I know he liveth. That word, I've got to point that out again to you, that E-T-H on the end denotes always, ever present. He lives now, he lives tomorrow, he lives, he lives, he lives, he continues to live. He's always lived. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. See, he ever lives. So he said that I know that my Redeemer liveth and shall stand. He believed in the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was going to actually come back to the earth again. He knew of his first coming, and he knew of his second coming. That he shall stand on the earth again. Verse 26, and though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet my flesh shall I see God. He knew that they were going to take, that one day this body was going to fall asleep in the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 4, Paul said, they sleep. These bodies are going to fall asleep one day. They're going to lay them in the grave. But he said, I know, though after my skin worms destroy this body, they've eaten up the body, yet in my flesh, Job said, shall I see God. He was expecting his flesh to live again. Are you expecting your flesh to live again? Job was. Job was a testimony to these Sadducees of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, but not only of Jesus Christ, because Christ resurrected. All those who are in Christ Jesus resurrect also. And so verse 27, he says, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. Yes, Job had a glorious vision of God and a great expectation in him. And the expectation Job had is an expectation that each one of us were saved or to have. And if any of those Sadducees were saved, they should have known that. And Jesus said, you do err, not knowing the Scriptures. Not only do you not know the Scriptures, you don't know the power of God. The power that God has. Turn with me, Book of Hebrews. Not only was Job a testimony of it, but Abraham was. In the Book of Hebrews, chapter 11. And look at what we have in verses 17, 18, and 19. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son. Wow. God come to Abraham and to Sarah and promised them a son. And when they didn't get that son and they were past the age of childbearing, Sarah talks Abraham into taking her handmaid Hagar and helping God out. And Ishmael's born. We have 12 silent years after Ishmael. And God appears to Abram and he shows him that he is the Almighty One. He is El Shaddai. And Abraham says, oh, that my son Ishmael might stand before thee, might live before thee. And God said, no. In Sarah, your son, Isaac, is the seed of promise. And now, he's told Abraham to take your son, your only son, Isaac, and offer him a sacrifice to me. Abraham showed his belief in God, did he not? What did he believe about God? He believed that God, the same God that was able to take Sarah's dead womb and make it live, make it bring forth a child, that same God was able to raise from the dead. Let's see if that's not so. Look at verse 18. Of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. Received him in a figure. What was the figure? The figure was like Christ being raised. Abraham believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. He believed that the Lord Jesus Christ was going to come give his life. He was going to die. He was going to be buried. And he was going to raise again. And that same mighty power that was going to raise Christ from the grave was going to able to raise Isaac from the dead. And he believed. Turn with me to the Book of Psalms. Not only did Job and Abraham teach of the resurrection, so did David. Psalms chapter 16. Look with me at verse 9. David said in verse 9, he says, therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. He was glorying in God. He was glorying in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, my flesh shall also rest in glory. What was David's expectation? What was David's belief? Belief in the power of God to raise from the dead. Everyone here tonight, well, might get ahead of myself. Everyone here tonight who is saved ought to believe in the power of God to raise from the dead. You ought to believe in the power of God to raise this body after it's laid in the grave, to raise it to life again. But on the basis of what? Oh, you say on the basis of Christ's resurrection. Yes. But on the basis of your salvation. You were dead in sins. Dead in sins. Raised his life. David said also in Psalm 17 and verse 15, he said, as for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. See, David knew after he died, he knew that one day that body was going to be raised because he was going to behold the face. I shall be satisfied when I awake. What was he talking about? Well, what sleeps? The soul doesn't sleep. Jehovah's Witness believes in soul sleeping. The soul doesn't sleep. Paul said, absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. What's he talking about? He's talking about the soul. The soul of a man goes to be with the Lord if he's saved. So what's David talking about here? He's talking about this flesh when it awakens. When it's in the grave and it awakens. You see the light. His Savior in his flesh. This power that we're talking about, the power of God, is amazing power. Turn with me to the book of Luke and chapter 9. Luke in chapter 9. And I want to read some verses here so you can get the flow here. Let's begin reading with verse 37. And it came to pass on the next day, when they were come down from the hill, much people met him. And behold, a man of the company cried out, saying, Master, I beseech thee, look upon my son, for he is mine only child. And lo, a spirit taketh him, and he suddenly crieth out, and it teareth him that he foameth again, and bruising him hardly departeth from him. And I besought thy disciples to cast him out, and they could not. And Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you and suffer you? Bring thy son hither. And as he was yet a coming, the devil threw him down and tear him. And Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit and healed the child and delivered him again to his father. Now in the book of Mark, in the same chapter, chapter 9, in the book of Mark, it tells us that the child appeared was as if he were dead after encountering Jesus, and the devil tore him. He was as if he were dead. He appeared to those looking on and those that were there as though he was dead. That helps you better understand what we're about to read now in verse 43. And they were all amazed at the mighty power of God. But while they wondered, everyone at all things which Jesus did, he said unto his disciples, and then he reveals that he was going to be taken and crucified and raised from the dead. Luke doesn't record that fact, but again, Mark records that fact that Jesus told them that. And they didn't understand that. They didn't understand those things. But the fact is, they were all amazed at the mighty power of God in casting that devil out. But here's one who is dead, appeared dead, and Mark says he took him by the hand and he lived. The mighty power of God to take that which is that dead, lifeless body and to restore it to life, to give it life. Thinking about that, turn with me to the book of Psalms in chapter 139, a glorious psalm. 139, and look at verse 14. The psalmist says here, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. Listen, God created this body. He made this body. There's nothing about this body. There's nothing about you and I that he does not know. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. Power of Almighty God. And he took the body which he made. He made it live. Isn't that amazing? Isn't the power of God amazing? Adam was not dead. Adam did not sleep. He just simply did not live. Until the power of God was breathed in his nostrils, became a living soul. Turn with me back to the book of Genesis, chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. Verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Listen, you read Genesis chapter 1, and we were there in Genesis chapter 1 this morning in the devotional period. In Genesis chapter 1, you read Genesis chapter 1, and is anything too hard for God who can take and make something out of nothing? And that which he made out of nothing, he takes the dust of the ground of it, and he forms a man. That man has no life until God breathes in it the breath of life. Is it too powerful? Is it too difficult for him then to take that which has lived and then died and raise it again? And not only that, change it. It's laid in the grave, a corruptible body is raised in incorruption. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. is raised, is laid in the grave, a mortal body, and is raised immortal. What's that mean? Mortal is subject to death, decay. What's immortal? Not subject to decay, death. Eternal life, everlasting life. Oh, the amazing, mighty power of God. And that same power that made man a living soul is able to take one who is dead in sins and trespasses and make him live. Give him everlasting life. Turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. Book of 1 Corinthians. Chapter 1. Verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Oh, Paul was persuaded of the preaching of the gospel being the power of God to take and make dead men, dead in sins and trespasses. Romans 1:16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To the Jew first, apostle to the Greek, or to the Gentile. Chapter 2, and verse 5 of 1 Corinthians, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in what? But in the power of God. Faith is not in the wisdom of men. If you have faith without the power of God giving it to you, you don't have faith. If only the power of God is able to give faith. We're talking about a faith that, and a hope that is an expectation based upon the promises of God. And so therefore it is a faith that is fully persuaded of that which it believes. Are you fully persuaded? Christ Jesus redeemed you from the curse of the law. He ransomed you. He paid the ransom. He has redeemed you. Turn with me to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 13. Verse 4, we read, for though he was crucified through weakness, talking about Christ, for though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we are also weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God. For you. Jesus Christ is a man. Became weak as a man. As God, he still had all the power of the Godhead bodily, but he submitted to flesh and blood. He submitted to death and burial. Peter, chapter 1. Well, before that, turn with me to 2 Timothy. Second Timothy chapter 1 and verse 8. He says, "Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God." In other words, he said, I am partaker of affliction because I dare preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't be ashamed of it. Listen, I'm fully persuaded that there's peace in the midst of affliction. There's peace in the midst of persecution. Ask our forefathers. I'm talking about the ones in the first century that gave their lives. The first martyr, James. Ask James. Ask Peter. Ask John. You think John had peace when he was put in that pot of oil and boiled? And some say he lived and survived that, was exiled to the Isle of Patmos, and then finally was beheaded or hung, whatever, or stretched, pulled apart. Well, then, ask John. Ask the Apostle Paul. He's saying there's peace and affliction. Preaching the gospel. An affliction comes upon you. He says there's peace in it. Why? How? How is there peace in the midst of affliction, in the midst of persecution, in the midst of those things? Power of God. Power of God resting upon you. I can't explain it. I've been through 3 surgeries. I wasn't going through a surgery yesterday at the airport, and all the red tape there was running me through, and it just about caused me to miss my flight. I was there at the airport 2 hours early and spent 2 hours, almost full 2 hours, down at the ticketing. And they finally had to walk me to the front of the security line to get me through there and get me onto my plane in time. And then I get there and they tell me I don't have a seat. Oh, you checked in late. You may not have a seat on you. No, I was down there for 2 hours. Well, that didn't matter. Well, you know, I'm all worked up. I feel like my blood pressure is probably sky high. I said to my wife when I got home, I said, "Well," I said, "I never feel a lot better." Why do we do that? Why do we get ourselves all worked up? Why don't we just take a deep breath and sit back and watch the Lord work it all out for us? I mean, He's doing it anyhow, working it all out for us. I wasn't so nerved up in Keith when I underwent those 3 surgeries. I laid there on that table. And they're getting ready, they're checking me, going through the pre-check and everything, and I'm just at full peace. That's not me. I can give you the example of yesterday to tell you that's not me. It's the power of God. You see, when we're facing those things, His power is with us. What a great power. We can rest assured in this promise. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5. Who are kept? Who? Who are kept? The elect. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. We're kept by the mind. mighty power of God. Isn't that something to rest in? That same mighty power that took and made Adam to live, that same mighty power that took this individual who was dead in trespasses and sins, gave to him everlasting life. That same mighty power is keeping me ready to be revealed in the last day, that great day of the Lord, when all the saints of God shall be made manifest. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we'll quit there tonight. Shall we have a word of prayer, and we'll be dismissed from this service to go into our business meeting. Our dear gracious Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for this study tonight, this word that we have read from your holy word. What mighty power we see our great God, Savior, have. That great mighty power that was manifested in creation, that great mighty power that gave man life to live. That same power has might to take those whom he chooses, dead in trespasses and sin, give them everlasting life. That same mighty power is keeping them preserved and ready to be revealed at the last day. Oh, Father, thank you for showing that to us. There's great peace. There's great comfort. See the mighty power our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you for those blessings that have been ours tonight. We pray now, dear Heavenly Father, as we prepare to go into our business, pray, Father, that you would direct and that you would bless, not according to our will, but according to thy will. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Right. If their visitors would like to leave, go ahead. We're glad to have you this evening.
Pastor Bourne called the church to order for the regular monthly business meeting of June. Brother Diener gave the clerk's report. Clerk's report approved by a motion from Brother McTaggart. Brother McTaggart. Second by Brother Wells. Brother McTaggart gave the treasurer's report. Treasurer's report was approved by a motion from Brother Diener and a second from Brother Rossberg. New business. Brother Rossberg made the motion to exclude Ron Keith as a member from Grace Baptist Church for non-attendance and a lack of support for the church, second by Brother Diener. Brother McTaggart made the motion to adjourn, second by Brother Wells, the church voted in favor. June 24th, the Sunday evening service, Brother Rossberg made the motion for the church to give the offerings in memory of Sister Barbara France, totaling $325 plus any extras that came in to the Romania mission, second by Brother McTaggart, the church voted in favor. Brother McTaggart made a motion for the church to add the Romania offering, add to the Romania offering enough to equal $1,000. Second by Brother Rossbrook, and the church voted in favor.
We have a motion, the reading of the report stand approved as read. Brother Mike, so move. Second to that. Brother Ron, second. All those in favor signify by raising the right hand. And those opposed, same sign. There are none. This time we'll have the reading of the treasurer. I think you can get through that, Brother Ron, or you need somebody to read it for you.
It's really hard to come to church and not be able to sing. I sang anyway, somewhat. All right, Grace Baptist Church financial report, June, in the year of our Lord, 2017. At the beginning of the month, $5,403 change. The offerings are listed.